उगले सर। इंगळ का सर उगले सर जॉईन झाले नाही वाटते।
आता आली सर त्यांची रिक्वेस्ट, केलं मी त्यांना ऍड.
त्यांना पोस्ट उगले सर। उगले सर सर तुम्ही कोर्स झालेले आहे ना
सर? चेक करतो। नाही सध्या तर नाही झालं। सर कोर्स झालो मी आता।
ओके सो नाउ यू कॅन शेअर युअर पीपीटी, जस्ट ट्राय इट।
ओके सर जस्ट अ मिनिट।
और नाउ ऑलमोस्ट ऑल पार्टिसिपेंट्स नाउ हैव बीन जॉइंड, सो वी विल नाउ स्टार्ट द सेशन और लेटर ऑन देन यू कॅन ट्राय टू शेअर द पीपीटी। I will first make the introduction and then you can start.
Okay.
उगले सर माझा आवाज क्लियर आहे इंगळकर सर
यस सर आवाज क्लियर
आवाज क्लियर
सो डियर पार्टिसिपंट्स वेलकम टू दिस एसटीडीपी organized by Department of Civil Engineering, Professor Ram Mege College of Engineering and Management, Badnera. So here, this STDP is on topic computational intelligence in earthquake resistant design. So to start with this STDP session, now we will have our first session. So for that, I welcome to our guest speaker, today's guest speaker, Professor Ashish Ugle sir. So first I will introduce Ashish Ugle sir, and then he will be presenting his session before you. So Professor Ashish Ugle is with our department from last 10 year. He has completed his BE from SDB Amrauti University and ME from Government College of Engineering Amrauti, and he is now presently pursuing his PhD in structural engineering. He has guided 12 UG projects and 5 PG projects for that as a supervisor. He is also filed one of the patent, and then he published 25 papers in international journal and 5 paper in national journal. He has also attended 11 STDP and then other 27 FDPs of one day or two day as an orientation of the faculty. He is also the member of Institute of Engineer, then Indian Society for Technical Education, then Indian Concrete Institute and Engineering Council of India. So I welcome to Professor A.B. Ugle. He has vast experience of teaching and learning various subjects of civil engineering. So today, Professor Ashish Ugle is with us. So I welcome to Ashish Ugle, sir, for this first session of this our STDP. And request him to start his presentation within a few minutes. Ugle sir.
Thank you, sir. Thank you very much for kind words and brief introduction. So I'm going to share my PPT. Is it visible?
Not yet, sir.
now.
So you have started your screen, but yet it is not visible.
Sir, wait for a minute.
Yes, now it is visible.
Sir, is it visible now?
Yes, sir.
Okay. Thank you again, Professor.
Yes,
and
start.
Yeah. Welcome, dear participants, and namaste to all. I'm Ashish Shubhapurji Ugle from Department of Civil Engineering, Professor Ramige College of Engineering and Management, Badnera. Right. In this CTP, I'm just giving the introductory part of the earthquake engineering. So the topic of the discussion or the session is introduction to earthquake engineering. Sir, is there? We all know whenever we discuss about the earthquake engineering, so there are a few points which are necessary to remember or necessary to know. Because what we are learning in the field of structural engineering, we already know, we always go for the earthquake resistant design analysis and all. But before this, it is must to know what is earthquake and how it affects the structure. So that's why this introductory topic I choose to brief. So some of the key points regarding this are, we must know the interior of earth, then engineering geology of the earthquake, the plate tectonics, the tectonic features of India, types of faults, location of the earthquake, and seismicity of the world. Actually, one by one we go through it. So actually, what is the interior of earth? So it is must to know the how the earth is composed of and how that geology is going on, how plate tectonics or the actions are going on. Then if we just consider about the India, how the tectonic features of India are there, then the number of the physical features which are including that the faults and the folds. So we have to discuss about it. Just start with the interior of the earth. If we discuss about the interior of the earth, then in this figure, from this figure, we can say that it is just divided into four parts. Simply, just go through one by one. So first part that we call is crust. The crust is the outermost layer of the earth on which we are just living. So this thickness of the crust is approximately from 5 to 40 kilometer, and it is consists of the light materials known as basalts and the granites, right? Then second layer, which is just below the crust, is called as the mantle, and it is nothing but the viscous fluid, right? And mostly responsible for the actions which are happening because of the earthquake, right? So the mantle is just viscous fluid, right? And it is able to flow. That's why the mantle is having ability to flow, and it is having the thickness or the depth approximately up to 2900 kilometers. Then the third layer is called as the outer core and fourth layer is called as the inner core. If we discuss about the outer core, then the thickness of that outer core is approximately 2200 kilometer and it is in the liquid form. Right? But inner core is in the solid forms and it consists of the heavy metals like nickel and iron. If we just go through the or just compare the temperature, then that temperature of that core is approximately equal to the 2500 degrees Celsius. That means the core of Earth is hot. So just taking an introduction for that parts of the Earth, the interior of the Earth, we just go through the small video so that it is more clear. So video is visible?
Yes, it is visible. So I have opened it. So now the folder is visible only. You have to share it again. Yes, now it is visible. पहले video open केला नंतर मग share करायला पाहिजे. सध्या stop करून restart करू शकता तुम्ही.
Actually, sound was clear on my side.
मी स्टॉप शेअरिंग केलं का?
नाही सर.
उगले सर स्टॉप शेअरिंग करा. पहिले तुमच्या स्क्रीनवर व्हिडिओ सुरू करा आणि मग त्याला शेअर करा.
हो सर.
आणि शेअर करताना वरती ऑप्शन असते ऑडिओ व्हिडिओ म्हणून पीपीटी च्या ऐवजी. No voice. Okay, sir, you can continue with the presentation.
Sir, I'm just continuing with my presentation. Actually, the audio is not clear.
Okay.
Not too sharing.
Actually, so please continue with the presentation.
Yes, sir. Yes. Okay. So through that video, it is clear how the interior of Earth is there. So after that, I'm going to say the convection currents. What is convection currents and all? While learning, while just knowing the interior of Earth, we know that the upper part is the crust, right, where we are living, and the innermost part, that is called as the core, which is very hot. So what is happening? There is a drastic difference of the temperature at the crust level and at the core level. Because of that, the drastic variation in the temperature, the convection currents are formed, right? So because of those currents, the plates or the tectonic plates are moving on the mantle. So mantle is completely responsible for the movement of the tectonic plates. We are just see this video to know about the convection current. So convection current. So in this video, we are just looking at the water is just filled in this burner, and which is just get heated with the help of this lamp. We just add one chemical into the water so that we are easily able to see the currents. Just add this color. So after starting up the lamp, the temperature of this water goes on increasing. So what is happening? The temperature of the bottom surface, the water at bottom surface of the bowl gets heated, and the temperature at the upper level is too low than compared with the lower water. So what is happening? Because of that variation in the temperature at the upper level and at the bottom level, currents are formed inside this bowl. So those currents are called as the convection currents. So convection currents, so same convection currents are formed inside the Earth's surface, because the core, the temperature of the core is too high and temperature of the crust is too low. So because of that temperature variation, convection currents are formed, and those are responsible for the movement of the tectonic plates. So I think we can hear the idea of the convection current. What is happening if we just look at this figure? So these are the currents which are formed. Suppose these are the anticlockwise current, these are the clockwise currents. So because of that movement, or the because of these currents, the mental parts are always in moving. So because of the movement of that mental part, the floating plates, because we are always on the tectonic plates. So floating plates or the floating plates are responsible for the earthquake actions. What is tectonic plate? So we just look what is tectonic plates or tectonic action. So the crust part is divided into a different tectonic plates. If we just majorly or just look the divideation, then it is just divided into major plates and the minor plates. Now first we just discuss about the major plates. So there are 7 major plates, which are Eurasian plate, Indo-Australian plate, Pacific plate, this Ocean plate, South American plate and the African plate. This is the Antarctic plate also. So it is just divided into some major tectonic plates as well as in some minor tectonic plates. So what is meant by that continental drift? Because what is happening, that part or the portion of the crust is continuously floating on the mantle, right? So it is very necessary to know about the continental drift. We just look this continental drift. So this video completely gives an idea regarding the continental drift. I'm just saying that the crust part is divided on the continents or the tectonic plates. So those tectonic plates are always in the motion because of the movement of the mantle and which is because of the convection current. What will going to happen, that is again mentioned in this video. Suppose ₹150 million in the future, what is happening? This is the drifting of the continents and it may connect after a few million years. It is mentioned that after 250 million years, 300 million years, and after 400 million years, all the continents may connect together as before. So from that video, from the small video, we just take an introduction regarding the continental drift. Because I just told that movement is called as the drift, and all the tectonic plates which are divided into different continents. So that's why this is called as the continental drift. So how the tectonic plates are divided? I already told you it is divided into 7 major plates. It is African plate, Antarctic plate, Eurasian plate, Indo-Australian plate, North American plate, Pacific plate, South American plate. And similarly, it is again divided into some of the minor plates which are listed here. So plate tectonics, let's see a small video regarding plate tectonics. So in this, just looking here, that these are the tectonic plates which are moving or drifting because of this flowing of the mantle. So here the mantle is there, and here the tectonic plates are moving because of those convection currents. Actually, this activity is solely responsible for the earthquake. Right? Hope you understood this small video, the concept from the small video. Okay, we continue. So,
just voice is breaking, sir.
So, Abdul, we just take a small introduction regarding the interior of Earth, tectonic action, how it is happening at all. In the next part, we are just moving towards the earthquake. So, what is earthquake? Actually, the earthquake is nothing but the sudden release of the energy. That's why shaking or the trembling caused by the sudden release of the energy is called as the earthquake. And this earthquake or the sudden release of energy, it happens only because of the some physical features which are already there in the crust, that is called as the faulting and the faults, right? So earthquake occurs within the earth crust along faults that suddenly release a large amount of energy, which is because of the continuous stress or the strain energy. The shaking of an earthquake is caused by the seismic waves, and seismic waves are generated when the rock within the crust breaks. What is happening? When that stress gets released through the rocks, so huge amount of energy is released, and that huge amount of energy is just transferred in the form of the waves, and that's why we learn the different types of waves in earthquake engineering. Take a look on elastic rebound theory. What is actually the elastic rebound theory and how that energy or the stress going to release? What is happening when the rock or the stress is formed inside these two rocks? Suppose this is the one rock and this is the another rock, and here there is a fault. That fault is nothing but the failure plane. Simply we can call this, it is a failure plane. So what is happening? The stress is continuously going to form because of the continuous moment of the beat. When this is the original position and stress is formed in the second position, we can see in this deformation happens. Every material or everything has own limit. So it has its own limit to just bear the stress or bear the some of the absorption of the energy. At this certain limit, what is happening? There is a failure because of that fault plane present in that. That's why the rupture or the cracks occurs and the rocks rebound to an undeformed shape. The energy is released. That energy we call the earthquake. So this is the plate boundaries. The different types of plate boundaries are there, again, which are responsible for the release of the stress or release of the strain energy because of that stored stresses. There are three types of the plate boundaries. One is the divergent plate boundary, then transform plate boundary, and the convergent plate boundary. So one by one, we just hear the idea regarding these types of the plate boundaries. I'm just going to share another video to know about the different types of the plate boundaries. So we go for the divergent plate boundary. From this video, you can just look here. The mantle is there, and the convection, because of the convection currents, moment starts and all. So in that transform, this divergent plate boundary, what is happening? The two plates are moving away from each other. So two plates are moving from each other. So you can easily see from this video, the two plates are moving away from each other. So this is called as the divergent plate boundary. The another is called as the convergent plate boundary. This is convergent plate boundary. This convergent plate boundaries, is happening, two plates are coming each other. So what is happening, suppose this is our Indo-Australian plate, this is the Eurasian plate. So that Indo-Australian plate is just subducting below this Eurasian plate. So because of that action, what is happening, there may be the crest form or the formation of the crest. That's why sometimes we say that the Himalayan range or the height of the Himalayan range is always increasing day by day. Last plate boundary, that is called as the transform plate boundary. So transform plate boundary. Easily see the transform plate boundary. There is a shearing action between the two tectonic plates, that is again called as the transform plate boundaries. So three types of plate boundaries are there. One is the divergent plate boundary, another is the convergent plate boundary, and third is the transform plate boundaries. So this is a just small introduction regarding the plate boundaries. There are three types of plate boundaries: divergent plate boundary, convergent plate boundary, and the transform plate boundaries. Right? Then we just a small introduction regarding the faults. I already explained to you that faults are nothing but the failure planes through which or from where the huge amount of energy is released. Right? So fault caused by the block of the crust. This is nothing but the part of the crust, and that's why the crust blocks are one over the another. So fault caused by the blocks of the crust pulling apart under the forces of the tensions are called as the normal faults. What is happening here? From this figure, you can see that suppose this is the hanging wall and this is the foot wall. Right? We just divide our crust into two parts, or crust block into two parts. One is hanging wall and another is the foot wall. So what is happening? So fault or the failure is because of the tension. Failure, when the failure is because of the tension, and in this situation when the hanging wall goes down, the foot wall, then this fault is called as the normal fault. Right? So in normal fault, the hanging wall block moves down relative to the foot wall block. So in normal fault, hanging wall block moves down to the foot wall block. Just want to share one video regarding this fault. Yes. Through this video, we can just clear an idea regarding the fault. So in this video, what is happening? This is the hanging wall and this is the foot wall. So the hanging wall goes down. The hanging wall goes down compared to that foot wall. And this is called as the normal fault. Right? Then we just take a look of reverse fault. What is reverse fault? So reverse fault, this reverse fault, what is happening? The hanging wall goes up than the foot wall. So you can just see the hanging wall goes up to the foot wall. I just want to clear the idea or the comparison between the two faults. One is the normal fault and another is the reverse fault. In the normal fault, hanging wall goes down to the footwall, and in reverse fault, hanging wall goes up to the footwall. So what is happening? In the normal fault, the fault or the failure is because of the tension, and in reverse fault, this fault or the failure because of the compression. Yes. Reverse fault. So what is happening in the reverse fault? That hanging wall goes up and it creates the compression, compressional failure. And before in normal fault, that was the tensional failure. So if we just look over the another, then the third is nothing but the shear stress failure, or the transform failure. First we see the normal fault, second is the reverse fault, and here the transform. Your video is visible.
PPT is visible. Please continue.
Yeah.
Your voice is breaking. It is not coming properly all the time. Please continue.
So third is shear failure. These are the fault types. First is the normal fault, second is the reverse fault, and third is the shear fault. These are the fault types. This is the slip fault or the normal fault. This is the reverse fault, and this is the strike slip fault. And this is the fault because of the shearing action. So duration. During the mountain building process, the rocks can undergo the folding as well. So this is the another physical characteristics of the crust. It's called as the folding. First is the fault. Sometimes rocks deform ductilely, particularly if they are subjected to heat and the pressure. At elevated or the higher temperature and pressure within the crust, folds can form from the compressional process. So entire mountain ranges like the Appalachians have extensive fold systems. The conditions of the weather, rock folds or folds vary with temperature, pressure, rock composition and the strain rate. So if we just summarize that, the folds is the physical characteristics which form only because of the variation of the temperature in the crust. And again, it is nothing but the result of the pressure and the stress which is coming on the crust because of the tectonic actions. So from this figure, it is clearly seen that these are the types of the folds which are formed. So this is called as the Z fold in this white plastic deep. Right? So we can see that it is nothing but the physical characteristics or the feature of the crust. Here also, the folds are produced. Folds and faults are mostly responsible for the release of sudden energy, or these creates the weaker section in the rocks through which the large amount of energy is released after the stress. What is happening? So in the faults and the faults, what is the it is nothing but that the geologic fault is a fracture in the earth crust causing a loss of cohesion and accompanied by the displacement along the fracture. Again, this is nothing but the result of the force or the stress exerted on the rock may cause a change in shape or the volume of the rock. It is again called as the strain. So the energy restored or energy stored in the crust is called as the strain energy, which can be released in the form of huge energy, which we call the seismic waves or earthquake. We just take an example. Suppose a dried branch is there or tree branch is there. We just applied a stress over it. What is happening? It just bear the stress up to its elastic limit. But once it reached to its elastic limit, then the sudden failure happens or the brittle failure happens. And that brittle failure is nothing but the release of energy, right? And similarly, it happens in the crust of the earth. These are the boundaries of the tectonic plates. So, earthquake locations around the world and their correlations to the plate boundaries. Plate boundaries are outlined by the red circles indicated by the past earthquakes and its centers. In this figure, the most earthquake centers are located. These are the some failures because of the fault planes or the faults. This is the moment on the equipment fault during the 1987 Bay of the Plenty earthquake offset this section of the McCracken Road in the equipment by almost 3 meters. Where the gap between these two sections, I'm just calling it as a section, because this is the suppose the dividation line or the failure line. So this separation is nearly 3 meters. In some of the examples here, you can see that the level difference in these two fault planes, approximately the height of that person is 5 feet, then the difference between the two levels after the failure and the fault plane is exactly equal to the 5 or 6 feet. Similarly, here also there is a drift at the land. That is the view is looking north along the railroad track that was twisted and offset 0.07 meter by the Motago fault. So this is nothing but the again the diversion of the fault. Also, the similar fault plane is seen. The earthquake faulting has caused an offset of the rows in a lettuce field near EI Centro. Such a fault with purely horizontal displacement, right as one looks across the fault, is known as the right lateral strike slip. So, we just conclude from this figure. Here there is a transform type of fault is there. So this failure is just because of the transform strike fault. So another concept is the ring of fire. So what is ring of fire actually? To this figure, we just take a look over it. It's called as the ring of fire. So ring of fire is an area in the basin of the Pacific Ocean where a large number of earthquake and the volcanic eruptions occur. 40,000 kilometer horseshoe shape, it is associated with a nearly continuous series of the oceanic trenches, volcanic arcs, and the volcanic beds. So this is nothing but the ring of fire. So most of the earthquakes, that means approximately 90 to 95% of the earthquakes happen on this ring of fire. Another is about 5 to 6% of the earthquakes or 70% of the world largest earthquakes happens on that Alphide Belt. So this is the Alphide Belt. So just clear an idea of the ring of fire and this Alphide Belt. So next part is earthquake. We already defined that the earthquake is nothing but the sudden release of energy. But it is very important to know from where or from which point that earthquake or that release of energy happens. So the point through which the earthquake or the energy is released, that is called as the focus. So from this figure, you can clearly take an idea that suppose this is the point through which this there is a sudden release of energy. So that point is called as the focus. So the point exactly above the focus, point exactly above the focus or the perpendicular to that focus on the crust or on the land is called as the epicenter. So the point within the earth where the faulting begins is called as the focus, or where the energy release is called as the focus, and the point which is exactly perpendicular or on the crust surface is called as the epicenter. Distance between that focus and the epicenter is called as the focal depth.
So the point directly, okay, after the sudden release of energy, what happens? That energy is transformed or propagated in the form of the waves, right? So it is very important to know the different forms or the different types of the waves. Seismic waves are categorized into four parts, mainly in two parts. First is the body wave and second is the surface waves. Again, body wave is categorized into two parts and surface waves is again categorized into two parts. So we see one by one. So seismic waves just categorized into two parts. First is the body wave and another is the surface wave. So in first part, body waves again categorized into two, the primary wave and the secondary waves. So primary wave and secondary wave, we just take a look with the help of a small video, the propagation of the primary wave. Sir, video is visible?
Yes, yet not, but it will get displayed.
This is the propagation of primary waves. So primary wave is propagated in this sense that the compressional and tensile waves are produced through the crust. Because the waves, primary waves, hope it is clear from this small video, the propagation of the primary waves. Primary wave is transformed in the form of compressional and tensile waves. We just take a look for the propagation of the secondary waves. This is a propagation of secondary waves. Secondary waves are propagated in the form of sinusoidal waves. So where we can see that up and down forms. Primary waves, these are the compressional and tensile waves. But in secondary waves, it is transformed in a sinusoidal type of waves. It is quite dangerous than the primary waves. Just brief the two type of waves, which are the body waves. The first is the primary wave and the second is the secondary wave. So about primary waves, these primary waves are nothing but the moves with the material particles. There goes extensional and compressional strains from the direction of the energy transmission. And under the S waves, oscillate at the right angles. So already an introduction with the help of the videos. Primary waves are transformed in the form of the extension and the compression. Secondary waves are transformed in the form of the sinusoidal waves, this up and down form. So, P waves are fastest, followed in sequence by S waves, Love waves, and the Rayleigh waves. Then, so the primary wave is nothing but the fastest waves. Travel through solid, liquid, or gases. It is again called as the compressional waves because it is transferred into the form of compression and tensile waves. S waves are the slower than the P waves. So, on the station, seismic stations, the P waves reaches first, then S wave. That means body waves reaches first and then the surface waves. So S wave or the secondary waves slower than the P wave and it is travel through solid only. It is the comparative point between the two waves that P wave or the primary wave can travel through solid, liquid or gases, but S wave transferred only through the solid waves. It is very fast, approximately having the speed of 7 km per second. And secondary wave is having the speed is approximately from 2 to 5 km. So from this again we can just conclude that the P wave is the fastest waves. Also, if we just take a spring, we just stretch it, just release, what is happening? The compressional and tensional waves are transferred through this hand towards the fixed support. And suppose we just tied a string and just keep one end in hand, just do a shake to it, then what is happening? The rope is in the form of sinusoidal waves, which is indicating the propagation of the secondary waves. Then the another type of waves are the surface waves. Surface waves are again categorized into two types, that is Love wave and the Rayleigh waves. So Love waves, see the video regarding propagation of Love waves. So here we can see that this propagation is nothing but the energy is propagated in the forward direction. With the same, the particles are moving in horizontal direction also. So this is the most dangerous type of the waves among the all. So we'll know the Love wave is always dangerous. Another is the last type of surface wave is the Rayleigh wave. So how the Rayleigh wave transform the energy? The elliptical movement is there, right? It is in the form of that up and down and moving towards the forward direction. Where the energy is moving towards the forward direction and the particles are moving in the elliptical direction. So this is nothing but a type of surface wave, that is Rayleigh wave. So if we just consider all the waves, that is primary wave, secondary wave, Love wave and the Rayleigh wave, then if we compare, then the Love waves are the most dangerous. So Love waves cause the surface motions similar to that by the S waves in the up and down with no vertical components. What is happening in the Love waves, the movement is in the horizontal direction. The Rayleigh wave make a material particle oscillate in an elliptical path that we seen through the video. So surface waves travel just below or along the ground surface. These are the surface waves are slower than the body waves. Rolling and side to side movement is there. And these are the waves which are mostly responsible to damage the buildings. We already took an introduction regarding these P waves, S waves, L waves, and the Rayleigh waves. Right? So, how that propagation of wave, or propagation of all the waves, yes. This video, we just conclude how the different types of waves are transformed the energy. Here there is another experiment of the spring. Here the idea of the P waves, which are the compressional and the tensile waves. Suppose we just give the jerk here at this end. What is happening? So you can see that the compression and tensions are moving in the forward direction. The energy is transformed for the forward direction. It's called as the P wave. Right? We just take look. Then it is a S wave. Just give the jerk, then the energy moves in the forward direction in the form of the sinusoidal waves, and yes, this is called as the S wave. Then another, that is the surface waves. What is happening in the surface waves in the case of the relics? Yes, here there is the elliptical movement of the particles, which are again dangerous to the structures and the buildings. You see, yes, this is the and this is the movement of the particles in the elliptical direction, and this is nothing but the propagation of the relic waves. At last, Love wave is there. So this is the movement in the Love waves, which is the propagation of the energy in the forward direction, but the movement of the particle is also in the horizontal direction. It is most dangerous. These are the types of the waves.
Only but you guys have
seismic waves of the earthquake. There is a quantification of that earthquake. Just measure the magnitude of that earthquake in the form of the energy, magnitude, and the intensity. Different scales are used to measure the magnitude, and which are those? Just seeing that the local magnitude or the Richter magnitude scale is there, then body wave magnitude, surface wave magnitude, seismic moment magnitude. Similarly, another concept is the intensity, right? As the magnitude is the quantitative measure, similarly the intensity is nothing but the qualitative measure. Different scales are there to measure the intensity. Those are Gastady scales, Pinafore scale, Rossi-Forel scale, Mercalli scale, modified Mercalli scale, and it is widely used in most part of the world. And last, the Medved-Carnik scale. The measurement of the earthquake is with the help of some of instrument. So that instrument is called as the seismograph. So it is used to measure the relatively weak ground motion and records which are formed or produced using the seismograph is called as the seismogram. So seismograph is the instrument record produced through or with the help of the seismograph. Another is the accelerograph. So accelerograph is the measurement for the strong ground motions. And records produced through this accelerograph is called as the accelerogram. So suppose this is the schematic representation of the seismograph or the accelerograph. So this is the equipment is called seismograph or accelerograph, and the record produced is called as seismogram or accelerogram. Here, there is a pendulum. This is the pen. So when the shaking is there, suppose this is the direction of the shaking. So what is happening? There is a marking using this pen on this record sheet. And that record sheet is nothing called as seismogram. Seismic wave where P waves arrives at the seismic station first and then S waves, and after that the surface waves reach to these seismic stations. Average speed for all these waves is known from the previous records, through which we can just consider or conclude the epicenter. Software and earthquake, the difference in arrival times at a seismograph station can be used to calculate the distance from the seismograph or the epicenter. Through this graph, if we just look here, here it is the primary wave which reaches the station first. After that, S wave reaches. What is between? The time difference between these two waves is nothing but the PS time interval. So using the previous records, easily calculate the locations of the epicenters. Suppose we are having the three stations and we just calculated the distances of the epicenters and just draw the three circles over there. So this is called as the three circle method. So through this three circle method, you can locate the epicenter also. So it is the most approximate method by using which we can just find out the epicenter. These are the horizontal motion. This is the horizontal seismograph. This is the vertical seismograph. This is for the horizontal motion and this is for the vertical motion. These are the some of the accelerograms or the seismograms. Previous records. This is the instrument. These are some typical recorded accelerograms. This is from the Mexico earthquake. This is the Imperial Valley earthquake. San Fernando earthquake. This is Uttarkashi earthquake. So past major earthquakes in India, we experienced the Bhuj earthquake in Gujarat in 26th of January 2001, having the magnitude of 7.7 and approximately casualties are 20,000. So similarly, there are the another few major earthquakes from Sumatra, Kashmir and Nepal. So the earthquake from that Sumatra is having the magnitude of 9.1 and having the casualties of 2,83,000, which was happened in the year of 2004. An increase in the magnitude implies, suppose we just take a look for the magnitude scale and we just compare the earthquake of magnitude 6.7 and earthquake of magnitude 7.7, then what is happening? The increase in the magnitude by 1.0 implies 10 times higher waveform. That means just experiencing the earthquake of 6.7 and comparing it with 7.7, then the waveform is 10 times more in the 7.7. If we just compare the energy is 31 times more than the 6.7. Always, if we just compare the earthquake of magnitude 7.7 and 5.7, then just we just multiply 31 by 31 for the comparison of energy. So the energy released in the earthquake of 7.7 is 1000 times more than the energy released in the earthquake of 5.7 magnitude. So most of the energy released goes into the heat and fracturing the rock, and only a small fraction of it fortunately goes into the seismic loss. Travel to a large distance, causing shaking of grounds and root, and hence damage to the structures. The energy released by 6.3 earthquake is equivalent to the release of energy in the atom bomb which is dropped on the Hiroshima. Earthquakes are often classified into different groups based on their sizes. Annual average number of earthquakes across the earth in each of these groups is also shown in the next table. It indicates that on an average, one great earthquake occurs each year. So through this table, we can just take a look. There is a group that is great earthquake, major earthquake, strong earthquake, moderate earthquake, light earthquake, minor earthquake, and very minor earthquake. Here there is the magnitude scale. That means suppose the magnitude of 8 and higher classified into great earthquake, magnitude of 7 to 7.9 is classified into major earthquake. Likewise, the annual average number is given. So the great earthquake happens annually once a year. Major earthquakes are 18 in numbers. Strong earthquakes are 120 in numbers. Moderate earthquakes having magnitude ranging from 5 to 5.9 are 800 in numbers. Light earthquakes are 6,002 times in a year, minor earthquakes having magnitude of 3 to 3.9, 49,000 per year. And we just take a look over this very minor earthquake, then it is having the magnitude of less than 3.0. It is having 1,000 per day and 8,000 per day. That means we are experiencing earthquakes every day. Because of that minor magnitude, we are unable to experience it. Another scale to scale the earthquake is the intensity. So intensity is the qualitative measure, right? Suppose one bulb of 100 wattage is there, then that 100 watt is the magnitude of that bulb and it is a quantitative measure. But we just take a comparatively look over there. So distance by distance, the intensity of bulb is dull. So that's why what is happening here, that means at near location, 100 lumens are there. At far location, 50 lumens are there. At very far location, 20 lumens are there. So suppose just take a look on the intensity scale. Intensity is goes on decreasing when the distance is increasing. So intensity goes on decreasing when the distance is increasing. Here the intensity is categorized into these from 1 to 12. This is the scale for the intensity. The evaluation is the first intensity is called as the insignificant. Second is very light. Third is light. Likewise. So the when the 12 intensity earthquake is there, that is called as the catastrophic and having the total destruction. It is depend on the intensity of earthquake which you are experiencing at the location or which the seismic station is experiencing. Depending on that, it can measure the intensity of the earthquake as well as the magnitude of the earthquake. This is the picture from the Bhuj, where the intensity of earthquake is 10. As the distance increasing, the intensity experienced at the far location is 7. This is the seismic map of India, categorizing the different zones or different seismic zones. Earthquake zones in India, the Geological Survey of India just categorized the India in different types of zone, different types of seismic zones. Zone 2, this is said to be least active seismic zone. Zone 3 is included in the moderate seismic zone. Zone 4, this is considered to be the high seismic zone. And at last, zone 5, it is the highest seismic zone. So India is having 4 seismic zones in which zone 1 is not there. Zone 2, zone 3, zone 4 and zone 5, which are categorized depending on the seismicity location. This is seismic map. This is the Himalayan range. And the geographical layout of the tectonic plate of the Indo-Australian plate. Some of the past earthquakes are mentioned in this figure. So, effects of that earthquake. What happens because of that earthquake? Earthquake is nothing but the transformation of the seismic waves or seismic energy because of the release of energy. So there are the ground motions, duration of the shaking, surface rupture, poor building design. So failure or the casualties or the effect of the earthquake is totally depend on some of the factors. Is ground motion, duration of shaking, surface rupture, for building design. Because of that earthquake, fire happens, liquefaction happens, landslide happens. And these failures leads to the casualties of lives. These are some of the past earthquakes and deaths given in this table. So if we just conclude here from this presentation, what we conclude we just know the interior part of Earth, how the tectonic plate action happens, how the tectonic plate action is responsible for the propagation of the seismic waves, and how the different seismic waves are responsible for the disaster. So I conclude here. Thank you to all the participants. Is there any questions? Khandvi sir?
So participants can have questions, few questions. You can type in the chat box. You can stop your screen share, sir. So few of the participants can ask the question. So thank you, Ugle sir, for having nice insights for introduction to earthquake engineering. So as now the Ugle sir has explained us, so there are various ground movements that is because of that P wave, S wave, L wave and R wave. And because of that, when the crust of the earth surface, it vibrates. So that vibrations may be in horizontal direction or in vertical direction or in elliptical shape. And because of that, so whenever now we are being designing a building or a high rise building or a huge structure like bridges and all other where we are having a deep foundation. So because of this type of earthquake effect, so there may be a vibration set into our structure. And as you know that the buildings, they are made up of most of the structure now today we are constructing, it is out of concrete. And for that strengthening purpose, we are using steel. So with the RCC material, whatever the buildings or whatever the structures now we are constructing, so we have to see that. So whatever the effect of earthquake was there, it may be at any intensity, our structure should not fail or our structure should not get damaged or there should not be any casualties. And this is therefore the responsibility of the civil engineer that we have to take utmost care for designing this type of structure, and they should be earthquake resistance. And now in today's, there are various tools and design strategies are there for making the structure earthquake resistant. And in that view only, this STDP has been organized. And now in later on sessions, we will proceed step by step towards the deep insight regarding that what are the computational intelligence is available with us civil engineer को हमारे जो resistance designs बनाने के लिए जो भी testing करना है उसके लिए there are many software tools are there and there are many of the good design strategies. So if we know that, then before constructing our structure, we can take that design, we can model it in the software, or we can test some of the whatever the IS code provisions we are given for the earthquake resistant design, and then we can make our structure sustainable in a particular earthquake zone. And for that purpose, now one by one we will go for that other sessions also. So in the next session, there will be a Dr. Rajan Vankhede sir will be there. They will be guiding us regarding the what are the IS code provisions for earthquake resistant design. And then later on stage, and then in next session, then Dr. Yogesh Khose sir will explain you how to start earthquake resistant design modeling using ETAP software. So there will be new insights are coming for our all our participants. So thank you, Ugle sir, for giving this introductory lecture on earthquake engineering, and I hope everybody has enjoyed that. So now today, within 5 minutes, we will stop this meeting, and then next session will be start at its exact time given. So I will start the session 10 minutes before, and we will allow you participants to join, and so that at the exact time we will start the expert session. So you can just type some of the your feedback in chat box, and then we will end this today's meeting. Gule sir.
Yes, sir.
One question is there in chat box, if you can answer. Effect on earthquake site, either convergent or divergent, which is more prominent?
Just a minute, sir. Any of it. Any of the type is having a huge effect on the structure, because structures are not built for bearing those effects.
So thank you, dear participants. Now today we will end this session, and then another session we will start 10 minutes before the our scheduled time, and then we will have a nice insights for the highest court provisions for earthquake resistant design. So thank you for being with us. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. Thank you.
Our next session will be at 1 p.m.